Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. This is Dr. Thomas Abraham, and in this video we're going to talk about the obstetrics and gynecology recall questions and answers. Let's begin. Question number one. A 22-year-old female asking for an emergency contraception within 8 hours of sexual assault and she is on 13th day of cycle. What is the emergency contraception of choice for her? See, we have few emergency contraception that we must remember. Let's look into it. The drug of choice for emergency contraception is levonorgestrel, and we give 0.75 mg of 2 tablets which are given 12 hours apart, or we give 1.5 mg one tablet, right? So this is the drug of choice for emergency contraception. And then the other one is IUCDs. IUCDs are also used as emergency contraception. But we must remember that IUCDs are the most effective method. Most effective method is IUCD, but not the drug of choice. Alright. So for emergency contraception, we give levonorgestrel. So what would be the answer of this? The answer will be levonorgestrel tablet, single dose 1.5 gram. Now if there was IUCD given here, then probably IUCD will be the answer. But if they have asked the emergency contraception of choice or drug of choice, then it will be levonorgestrel tablet. Okay, let's move on to the next one. A 23-year-old lady presents with complaint of post-coital bleeding. On per speculum examination, the following is seen. You see on the speculum examination, you see red finger-like projections, right? This is a finger-like projection. Let's look into the details of cervical polyp. See, cervical polyp are small fragile growth that hang from a stalk and push through the cervical opening. And most importantly, we need to know the findings of cervical polyp. In most of the time, they're gonna give you a history of vaginal bleeding often after intercourse. In this question also, we saw that there was post-coital bleeding, right? And this bleeding usually occurs between the normal menstrual periods. So in between the periods, post-coital, there will be bleeding. So that will be the history given in cervical polyp. And in the speculum examination, you can see that smooth, red, finger-like projection from the cervical canal. See, the management is very simple. We just, either twist the polyp and we'll take it out, or we can remove it by tying a surgical string around the base and then cutting it off, fine? And then the polyp base is removed by electrocautery or with a laser. Now let's see here, there was also one option that there can be, cervical fibroids are very large, they're gonna efface the entire cervix. Cervical carcinoma, that is quite confusing whether it can be cervical carcinoma. Let's see how cervical carcinoma looks like. See, on the left side we see this cervical polyp, red lesion, red purple lesion, finger like growth. On the right side you have the carcinoma of the cervix. See, carcinoma of the cervix is like cauliflower like growth. So it's easily distinguishable. So this is polyp and there is cauliflower. If there is cauliflower like growth, then it is carcinoma of the cervix. So what would be the answer of this? See, complaint of postcoital bleeding and speculum examination is characteristic of cervical polyp. So answer is cervical polyp. Now let's look into the question number 3. Patients presents at 11 weeks period of gestation with mild spotting per vaginum. On transvaginal sonogram, gestational age is corresponding to 5 weeks. So this is the correct gestational age, right? Gestational age, and only gestational sac is seen without fetal node. So there is no fetal node. Now imagine at 5 weeks, you won't even see fetal node. 5 weeks, you actually cannot see fetal node in ultrasound. The uterus size is normal. If they're saying uterus size is normal, that means it is corresponding to the gestational age. Now what is the diagnosis? See, two options that we confused here are missed abortion or threatened abortion. Let's look into it, right? Here are the definition and everything about threatened abortion and missed abortion. In threatened abortion, there will be spotting per vaginum. That's what we see in the patient. And on the PA examination, what do you see? The height of the uterus is equal to period of gestation. Now, in they have mentioned that the height of the uterus is normal. That is, the height of the uterus is corresponding to period of gestation, right? So this is more indicating towards threatened abortion. And on ultrasound, what do you see? Live fetus and the cardiac activity is present. But here in this scenario, we have seen that on transvaginal sonogram, the patient's gestational age is just 5 weeks. In 5 weeks, you can't see fetal node. You can't see the fetal node, right? So this is a case of threatened abortion. Now, why not missed abortion? Because they have mentioned that the uterine size is normal. But on PA examination in missed abortion, the uterus size is less than the period of gestation. But they have mentioned that the uterus is normal, right? So it won't be missed abortion. So the right answer would be threatened abortion. Okay, let's move on to the next one. Question number 4. A woman after hysterectomy shown with distended abdomen. What is the electrolyte imbalance seen in her? See, distended abdomen post-surgery. This is like a surgery question. Post-surgery, if there is distended abdomen, there should be two things that should come to your mind. One is paralytic ileus or functional obstruction of the bowel, right? Let's look into the complete explanation of it and then we come to the answer. See, abdominal distension post-surgery, it may be hysterectomy or CS. You have to think of two conditions. One is paralytic ileus and then is early mechanical bowel obstruction. See, in paralytic ileus, it occurs in first few days. And most important is paralytic ileus is prolonged by hypokalemia. Paralytic ileus is prolonged by hypokalemia. So if the patient is having hypokalemia, it may either provoke the presence of paralytic ileus or it may prolong the actual paralytic ileus that is caused due to abdominal surgery. So what would be the management of it? Nothing per oral. And then we give IV fluids, Ringer's lactate, because it contains potassium and it is usually self-limiting. But if it is early mechanical obstruction because of adhesions, right? It occurs only in the post-operative 5th and 7th day. And then the X-ray will be showing dilated loops of small bowel and there will be air fluid levels. And the management is surgical, right? So what is most important here? They have asked just the electrolyte imbalance. So what would be the answer? It will be hypokalemia, because hypokalemia prolongs the paralytic ileus, right? So what would be the answer? Answer will be hypokalemia, because hypokalemia prolongs the paralytic ileus. So what is the electrolyte imbalance seen in her? It's hypokalemia. Fine, let's move on to the next question. This is very simple. You see bilateral sausage shaped mass. When do you see bilateral sausage shaped mass? You see in hydrosalpinx. That's the answer. Straightforward, right? Whenever you see this sausage shaped mass, it looks like sausage, right? So if it is bilateral, then the straight answer will be hydrosalpinx. Let's move on to the next one. Patient is in labor. On per vaginal examination, cervix is 5 cm dilated and fully effaced. Which stage of labor it is? See, stage 1 of labor is divided into two phases. One is latent phase and the second one is active phase. This latent phase is all about effacement and it begins with the onset of regular contraction and it ends with the acceleration of dilation up to 5 cm. Up to 5 cm dilation is latent phase. And from 6 to 10 cm is active phase. See, stage 1 active phase begins with the acceleration of dilation and it ends with 10 cm, that is complete dilation, right? So from 6 to 10 cm it will be active phase and up to 5 cm it will be latent phase. Stage 2 is descent and stage 3 is delivery of placenta. Patient is in labor, 5 cm dilated, fully effaced, What would be the answer? Latent phase. Let's look at the next question. A woman with secondary amenorrhea with history of curettage. This is very important. History of curettage for abortion. FSH is 7 milli international unit per ml. What is your likely diagnosis? See, FSH 7 international unit per ml is normal. Milli international unit per ml is normal. Now let's look into the explanation of it. See, FSH level is normal between 5 to 20. Okay. And if FSH is less than 5, then you have to think of hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. Gonadotrophic hormones are less. FSH and LH is less. Why it can be less? Because of hypothalamic or pituitary failure. Now, if the question have mentioned more than 20 international unit per liter, then it's gonna be hypergonadotrophic hypogonadism. Now, when hypergonadotrophic happens, it happens in ovarian failure. So, if there is ovarian failure, there won't be estrogen. If there is no estrogen, there won't be negative feedback. If there is no negative feedback, there will be high FSH. Fine. So, let's look into the question. In the question, the FSH level was 7 international unit per liter. It's normal. So it can't be hypothalamic or pituitary failure. So two options we can take it out, right? We know that it's not pituitary failure. In pituitary failure, FSH will be less than 5. It's not ovarian failure, because in ovarian failure, FSH will be more than 20. Now, what is most important here is history of curettage for abortion. See, if there is history of curettage, the basal layer of the uterus will be removed. When the basalis layer of the uterus is gone because of excessive curettage, there will be adhesions. And if there is adhesions, which is what we call uterine synechiae, the syndrome is known as Asherman syndrome. It's very important. All the time they ask this question, Asherman syndrome. So if there is an history of a curettage, you go straight to uterine synechiae, also known as Asherman syndrome. Question number 9. Identify the given maneuver. See, Leopold's maneuver is very important maneuver. There will be some question regarding Leopold's maneuver. Let's look into the explanation. See, Leopold's maneuver, we have 4. See, the Leopold 1 is to determine consistency, shape and mobility. In here, we're gonna palpate the superior surface of the fundus. Second one, we check the both sides of the uterus, and it is to determine the direction of fetal back. Then we have the third, which is what shown in the question. Leopold's maneuver number 3 is to determine the part of the fetus at the inlet, whether it is cephalic presentation or breech presentation, fine, and its mobility. And the fourth Leopold's maneuver is to determine the fetal attitude. So in the question, it was Leopold's maneuver 3. So the answer will be Leopold's maneuver 3, right? Question number 10. What is the true conjugate? Whether it is from upper border or lower border or posterior border to sacral promontory. Let's look into the explanation. See, true conjugate is from the upper border of the pubic symphysis. The obstetrical conjugate is from the mid of the pubic symphysis, and diagonal conjugate is lower border of pubic symphysis to sacral promontory. So what would be the answer here? Upper border of pubic symphysis to sacral promontory. Question number 11. They have given you this ultrasound finding, and it's very simple. What do you see here? You see snowstorm appearance. When do you see snowstorm appearance? Snowstorm appearance is seen in hydatidiform form mole, right? Molar pregnancy. So the answer was straightforward. You know this appearance, snowstorm appearance. You know it looks like grapes in real life. So it more or less looking like a grape, snowstorm appearance, and this is hydatidiform mole. Question number 12. 30-year-old female came in for regular checkup, found with 6 cm to 6 cm unilocular ovarian cyst. What is the next step in management? See, unilocular ovarian cyst is typically a simple cyst. Now let's go into the explanation. See, we never do ovariectomy for simple cyst. Never ever go for ovariectomy for simple cyst. Now two options that you have to look for, A and D. Let's go into the explanation. See, the most common cause of simple cystic mass in the reproductive age here is physiologic functional cyst. It can be either luteal or follicular cyst. And most of these functional cysts are managed expectantly. You do observation, but surgery is indicated when, if there is torsion, there will be acute onset of pain, that it will be severe pain, right? So what we do in most of the functional cysts, we just do observation. And what we do after doing observation, we go for a sonogram, and the sonogram will show what, a simple cyst. And what we do, we follow up the patient in 6 to 8 weeks. The patient will come in 6 to 8 weeks, we again go for the ultrasound, and usually functional cyst spontaneously resolves by 6 to 8 weeks, and it typically occurs in reproductive age years, and we also give oral contraceptive. Why we give oral contraceptive to this patient? Oral contraceptive is used to prevent further functional cyst from forming. We need to stop further functional cyst from forming, so that's why we give oral contraceptive. When do we do laparoscopy? Laparoscopy is done if it is more than 7 cm. This patient is having around 5 cm, right? Now when do we do CA125? CA125 is done if the age is more than 45. Why do we do CA125 if the age is more than 45? It's because of risk of ovarian cancer. In age more than 45, the patient will have a risk of ovarian cancer. Fine. So what would be the answer in this case? We see 6 cm. If it is more than 7 cm, then we go for surgery, and most of the time for functional cysts, we go for follow-up and combined oral contraceptive pills. CA125, why not CA125? Because the patient age is 30 years old. She is reproductive age years. It is simple cyst. You don't have to go for any of this laparoscopy or ovariectomy. Fine. Let's move on to the next one. Question number 13. Patient underwent oral glucose tolerance test at 27 weeks of gestation. Her fasting blood glucose was 130 milligrams per deciliter. At 2 hours, the blood glucose was 200 milligram per DL. See, the fasting is 130 and the 2 hour blood glucose is 200 milligrams per deciliter. It's too high. What is the next step in the management? Let's look into the description and then we come back to the answer. Okay. See, we have 3 hour 100 gram oral glucose tolerance test, and the definitive test, and this is the definitive test for glucose intolerance in pregnancy. Now let's look at the normal values. Normal values are fasting blood sugar of less than 95, 1 hour less than 180, 2 hour less than 155, and 3 hour less than 140. If two values are abnormal, gestational diabetes is diagnosed. Now look at this patient. This patient was having fasting blood sugar of 130. It should be less than 95. At 2 hours, she is having 200. It should be less than 155, right? So these are two values. This is the diagnosis of gestational diabetes. It is very high. You have to admit her and start on insulin. Why do you need admission? See, if you need to continue her on insulin, what do you have to do? You have to measure, know how much insulin is required, and you need to adjust the dose according to her, right? So you have to admit her and start the insulin. Let's look into the option. See, start insulin and check it 34 weeks. How do you start insulin without knowing how much insulin you have to give? So you have to admit her, get to know how much insulin you have to give, adjust the dose, and then the patient start on insulin. Why do you need to repeat oral glucose tolerances when already she has been diagnosed with gestational diabetes? You don't have to. And start insulin and monthly checkup. You can't know how much insulin to give, so you have to admit her first. All right, let's move on to the next. Question number 14. Contraindication of given image. Last time they asked the image of copper T, right? This time they have asked the contraindication of the given image. Now let's look into some of the description and then we go straight to the answer, right? The absolute contraindication for IUCDs, intrauterine contraceptions, are pregnancy, pelvic cancer, vaginal bleeding and salpingitis or PID. There are a lot of contraindications are there, but I want you to remember at least these four: pregnancy, pelvic cancer, vaginal bleeding and salpingitis. So what would be the answer? The answer will be PID. In PID or salpingitis, it is contraindicated. Let's move on to the next. In the ultrasound, you can see peripherally arranged follicles. And where do you see peripherally arranged follicles? You see in PCOS, polycystic ovarian syndrome. And what is this called? This appearance is called pearl of chain appearance. Very simple. If you know it, you got this answer right. This is PCOS. Fine. Now let's look into this question. Question number 16. In a retroverted uterus, a mass is present in the lower uterine cavity and it is palpated through posterior fornix. The patient is nulliparous and infertile. Tenderness is present in the posterior fornix. What is the diagnosis? Let's go to the explanation. See, triad of endometriosis is fixed retroverted uterus, firm tender adnexal mass and infertility. See, in fibroid uterus, it can be retroverted, but it's non-tender. Fibroid uterus is also non-tender. See, in adenomyosis is going to be large uterus. But here you see the triad here. See, retroverted uterus, infertile, and there is adnexal mass and tenderness, right? So the answer is endometriosis. Most dependent part in a sitting female. See, in a sitting female, not in supine position, in sitting female, the most dependent part is pouch of Douglas. Okay. Next question. A baby born to diabetic mother is jittery and hypoglycemic after delivery. What is the reason for hypoglycemia? So in neonates, hypoglycemia is caused by persistent hyperinsulinemia from excessive prenatal transplacental glucose. So in prenatally, because of the transplacental glucose, this baby is having hyperinsulinemia. So because of excess insulin, this patient will go suddenly to hypoglycemia. And because of hypoglycemia, the patient will be having jitteriness. So the answer is, what is the reason for hypoglycemia? It's excess insulin. Now let's look at question number 19. This is a cakewalk. They have given the image. And see, 14-year-old presents with cyclical abdominal pain has not attained menarche yet. And presents with following image. What is your diagnosis? See, this is the image. And the diagnosis is imperforate hymen. In this patient, usually what happens, there will be secondary hematocolpus. Because the hymen is imperforate, the blood will keep on accumulating and it will keep on accumulating behind the imperforate hymen. So what do? We do a surgical incision, which is cruciate incision, X-shaped incision on the hymen. Let's look into this given image. Identify the given image. I want you to know just the simple meaning of it. See, what do you mean by amniocity? Amniocity is how many sacs are present. Right? How many sacs are present here? 1 and 2. So it is diamnionic. How many sacs are present? Only 1 is present. So it is monoamnionic. Now what do you mean by chorionicity? Chorionicity is about how many placenta are there. See, here we have 1 and 2 placenta. So it is dichorionic. Here how many placenta you have? 1 and 2 dichorionic. How many placenta are there here? Here only 1 placenta is there. So it is monochorionic. Right? So what would be the answer here? The answer will be dichorionic. Right? And diamnionic. See, how many placentas are there? 2 placenta, so dichorionic. How many sacs are there? 2 sacs are there, so it is diamnionic. Right? So the answer will be dichorionic, diamnionic. Let's move on to the 21st question. The contraceptive contraindicated in postpartum is oral contraceptive pills. Why? Estrogen decreases breast milk production. Now this question, what is the mode of insertion of following contraceptive? What is this contraceptive called? It is called Assure. See, Assure is available in France and not yet in India. It's like a spring-like device and it's a micro coil. This is introduced using a hysteroscope and it is inserted through the vagina into the uterus and then into each fallopian tube. And eventually in 3 months time, there will be scar tissue. So the sperm cannot pass through to fertilize the egg. What is the mode of insertion? Is hysteroscopic. You go inside, you put the coil here. Fine. Question number 23. 40 cc fetal material was detected on ultrasound, planned for evacuation, but the catheter goes deep into the uterus without resistance. What should be your next step? Catheter has gone deep. What does that mean? That there is uterine perforation. Uterine perforation is there. That's why the catheter has gone deep into the uterus. And there is no resistance. So that means there is uterine perforation. So what should be your next step? This is an emergency. Uterus has been perforated. What are you gonna do? You're gonna do immediate laparoscopy. So the answer is immediate laparoscopy to be done. I think these were the questions. So thank you for watching. And please comment down below how many questions you've made it right, or if you want to add anything in this. So see you in the next video. Bye bye.